Okay.
Hello everyone, we are back again to this third symposium on dating by physical methods applications in archaeology and geoscience. And we have this third lecture. So we have a pleasure to receive Dr. Georges Polymeris. Dr. Georges Polymeris is a researcher at the Archaeometry Laboratory, Institute of Nanoscience and Nanotechnology at the NCSR Democritus in Greece. He has also worked in Istanbul and Ankara, Turkey. His research interests included the techniques of thermoluminescence, OSL, EPR, radiocarbon dating, and Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy, and the corresponding applications such as analysis of complex experimental curves of TL, OSL, and VTIR. They studied a thermal fading of luminescence signals arising from a mixture of localized and delocalized recombination in several reference materials such as feldspar and apatite, and several alternative applications of luminescence besides dating and dosimetry have been reported. A list of these most recent applications would include the use of luminescence as a probe for archaeometry in pottery and masonry, solid-state bioactive characterization of bioactive materials, and oxidation study of magnesium silicate thermoelectric materials. Major contribution includes the pioneer study of thermal-assisted OSL in aluminum oxide with carbon, and quartz towards assessing stable very deep electron traps, and thus luminescence age-limited extension beyond the age of 1 million years. He's currently carrying out a multi-level study of TA-OSL characteristics in various materials, both natural, quartz, apatite, etc., as well as artificial beryllium oxide, aluminum oxide, attempted also a VDT spectroscopy approach using EPR. So, Professor Georges Polymeris, thank you for accepting this invitation, and the floor is yours.
So, thank you very much for inviting me, and congratulations on the conference. I will try to keep you updated with a very, let's say, a Greek approach about extending the chronological limits of the luminescence dating beyond 1 million of years. So, I guess that you're listening me well. So, I will start by presenting the advantages and the disadvantages of the luminescence dating. As an advantage, the technique is accurate, independently controlled by other techniques. It's low costed. There is a lot of know-how and technology all around the world. There is a widespread applicability to archaeogeological issues, as well as successful applications up to date. Okay, but of course, as we know very well our technique, we know very well the disadvantages. Which are these disadvantages of luminescence? And in luminescence, I mean thermoluminescence, optically stimulated luminescence, infrared stimulated luminescence. At first, the ages depend on a number of parameters like humidity, organic content, etc., and are model dependent. Secondly, there are very relatively high errors, which in many cases can exceed 10 to 15%. We need a time-consuming chemical pretreatment procedure in red or dim light condition. There is, of course, a limited number of applicable minerals, and of course, the age limits of the technique are very, very important. In this presentation, I will try to present you my work, which starts since back to 2010. In order to deal with the last three disadvantages of luminescence dating. As you can see, current luminescence age limits do not extend 350,000 years for TL, and this is a very optimistic case. 500 to 700 thousand years in the case of OSL, 800,000 years in the case of IRSL, and in the case of the thermally transfer OSL, we don't have ages older than 1 million of years. Of course, if you compare with the radiocarbon and the age limits, that do not exceed 60,000 years, okay? And, luminescence can date far behind, far older. But of course, we need more. We need to go back to the past more deeper. And there is also an experimental approach that ages that where we deal with ages very close to 1 million year, there is a systematic underestimation between 10% and 50%, and this is according to the latest review article by Anna Wintle and Gregor Zadamitz in 2017 in the radiation measurement. So let me explain why we need to go deeper in the past, okay? So, quaternary. Quaternary is an age time period that spans almost up to 2.5 million years ago. So, if you start going deeper, you can see that from 20 and 15,000 years ago, you can monitor the origin of writing, the state of societies, civilization, agriculture. This is the well-known period of Anthropocene, Anthropocene in Greek, okay? And this period is very well dated using thermoluminescence and carbon-14. 20 to 300,000 years ago, you can see there is the study of Homo sapiens, which is also studied very well using minorly carbon-14 and luminescence. 800,000 years ago, there is the rapid brain growth, the transmission from the rather warm and wet Pliocene to the climatically fluctuating Pleistocene. And this period is also studied between using the OSL and IRSL. However, as we go deeper, meaning the expansion of Homo erectus out of Africa, which spans between 1.6 and 1.8 million years ago, the beginning of the oldest stone tool making 2.5 million years ago, and of course the development of the bipedal walking, these are ages, these are periods that are not studied because we have very difficulty, much difficulty in using a robust technique to date. Of course, we can use potassium argon, but or some cases EPR, but this is still difficult. Morphological, anatomical, and socioeconomic evolution, as well as cultural development of the hominids, the construction of the ancient ecosystem, and the ancient past environment. Study the changes in the Earth's environments from intrinsic or astronomical causes need to verify experimentally the duration, meaning the beginning and the termination, of each one of these phases, and I mean all these phases, starting from today up to almost 4 million years ago. So, luminescence cannot go up, theoretically, it cannot go deeper than 1 million years. So let's see. We have almost more than 3,000 available luminescence readers working at this time all over the globe, not only for luminescence, also for research and development of materials. So the most established materials is quartz. We are referring to naturally occurring materials. It's quartz, feldspar, and calcite, which please remember that is not yielding natural OSL signal. On the right of your screen, you can see the majority of the signals that we can use with luminescence in order to make dosimetry or dating. Thermoluminescence, optically stimulated luminescence with green, blue, or violet infrared wavelengths, infrared stimulated luminescence, post-IR OSL, post-IR IRSL, multiple electronic temperature post-IR IRSL techniques, thermally transfer OSL, thermally assisted OSL, time resolved, infrared photoluminescence, and radiofluorescence. So, from my point of view, I will try to discuss the TAOSL, which is a technique that we think we have been working since the last 10 or 12 years. And my professor and supervisor, my PhD professor Kittis, it was his idea. And we have started making a lot of effort and a lot of results towards this direction. A short overview, we have the traps, each trap in the glow curve corresponds to one TL glow curve, to one glow peak, and the sum of the glow peaks, it's the glow curve. So if you want to categorize the traps, we have region one, meaning between room temperature and 150, which is unstable and shallow with lifetimes less than 3 hours. So it's this type of region is not good for dating. Typical example, the 110 TL peak in quartz. Between 150 and 300 degrees Celsius, we have region 2. These are the dosimetric traps, which are very important in case of dosimetry, personal or environmental. Typical, here are the main dosimetric peaks in aluminum oxide and beryllium oxide, with lifetimes that cannot exceed 550 years. Region 3 consists between 300 and 500 degrees Celsius. These are the dating traps, meaning typical is the 325 Celsius TL peak in quartz, which is supposed to dominate to the contribution of the OSL signal. And the lifetimes can exceed to 1 million of years or even more. Of course, we have the fourth region, which deals with temperature lower than room temperature, of course. These are typical low spectroscopy traps. And of course, I have to say that we have also the fifth region, which has traps higher, which are the localization temperature is higher than 500 degrees Celsius. This is really important because you can understand that when every time we are using nominal, original, or conventional OSL, IRSL, TL, dosimetry, dating, whatever, using luminescence, we don't use levels that can be thermally excited at temperature higher than 400 or 500 degrees Celsius, okay? But most of the TL and OSL phosphors are wide band materials band, have wide band gap, so they hold some very deep energy levels, which are called very deep traps hereafter. We call them very deep traps because, and we have motivated in order to correspond to temperatures that are having a peak maximum beyond 500 degrees Celsius. Okay, there have been indirect proofs and consensus about whether in aluminum oxide we have indirect, we have very deep traps, and there have been a huge work from Ural State University towards this direction between 1990 and 2004. But unfortunately, nobody, except one paper, this court of Milman in 1998, the measurement of such a signal was not evident. Okay, and why? It was very difficult because of many regions. The first reason is the interference of the high infrared background at such temperatures up to 900, which makes these measurements quite problematic. The photoionization cross-section of these traps that is expected to be very low at ambient temperatures, meaning at room temperature or up to 50 degrees Celsius. Instrumental limitation for the commercially available luminescence readers. You all know that all RISO or Heidelberg instruments, there is a requirement that the TL maximum temperature of heating does not exceed 700 degrees Celsius. The thermal quenching possibility and the relative high cost of a luminescent reader to circumvent efficiently all drawbacks above. So, that's why we invented thermally assisted optically stimulated luminescence. Translation is from Google Translator. If it's wrong, you can forgive me, but I don't know Portuguese. So, first of all, we irradiate the material, the sample, naturally or inside the lab. The second step is make a TL readout up to 500 degrees Celsius to empty all conventional trap. And step C, you can do two different alternative but equivalent issue measurements. You can either have OSL at a high temperature, which is isothermal TOSL, according to my paper from 2010, or alternatively, you can make OSL and TL simultaneously, which is the TOSL with linear heating according to Sony et al. From 2012. It is important to realize that there is not any radiation between step B and step C. So, as I remember, I have many times studied the PhD of Professor Kittis, and it says that after a first TL, in thermoluminescence, we don't have any signal left, okay? In conventional traps, of course, okay? This was mandatory, and if you see all books of McKeever in 1980s and 1990s, it's a specific point that after the first EL, we have a background signal like that. In OSL, it's much more complicated. However, you can see that after the first TL, we have huge signal. And this is an example of signals of TAOSL using linear heating in the case of aluminum oxide for various heating rates. And this is in Durango apatite again for various heating. But this linear TAOSL using linear heating has been a concept that was advanced in India. So our concept is the isothermal TAOSL. And you can see that we have huge signal after removing all TL up to 500. It's really important. Imagine that you make one TL measurement up to 500 and then you measure all this signal in aluminum oxide, in beryllium oxide, and in calcium fluoride, and the numerics indicate the temperature of the measurement. Okay, so the signal is huge, and you can see that also it's bell-shaped, meaning it has a peak maximum and then decreases again. Of course, if you go to other type of material, Durango apatite, calcium chloride, salt, potassium feldspar, and some other type of quartz, you see that we still have very rich signal. This is 20,000 counts, this is 10,000 counts, okay? But the signal shape is somehow different. It is an ordinary decaying signal, okay? So, what makes these two shapes different? It's the recombination pathway. In the case that we have a peak shape method like aluminum oxide, calcium fluoride and beryllium peaks, meaning we have TAOSL with peaks, the signal, the charges recombine via the conduction band. And this was verified experimentally by using time-resolved TAOSL for aluminum oxide, okay? But in the cases that we have the signal which is decaying like an ordinary OSL signal, we have not, let's say, localized recombination state, even tunneling, meaning the signal, the charges do not go via the conduction, but they go to a metastable state and they find some very close local state, and they recombine via that, but not without going in the conduction band. This is the case for the most materials like quartz, salt, apatite, feldspar, and barium sulfate. Okay, it is important to understand that we are dealing with measurements versus stimulation temperature. Okay, and it is quite important to realize that in most materials like quartz, beryllium oxide, aluminum oxide, we have thermal quenching. So, thermal quenching correction is really important, and we need this correction in order to calculate the optimum stimulation temperature for the OSL. For example, if you make the ordinary conventional OSL measurement, you can see that the signal decreases with increasing temperature, okay, because the trap is getting depleted. On the contrary, TAOSL, as you increase the temperature of the measurement, the signal is increasing. You can see here that there are some kind of tricky situations like quartz and beryllium oxide. You see that the signal is decreasing and then increasing, but this signal is uncorrected. If you correct, we know that beryllium oxide, quartz and aluminum oxide suffer from thermal quenching. If you correct for this quenching, you have this behavior with increasing signal versus temperature. So, after all this type of situation, what is important to understand? It is important to understand that the trap's capacity, okay, is really important. You see, when we have OSL or high doses, we have the linear part, we have the lowest detectable limit, we have the D0, which is saturation, okay? And this is the 2 times D0. According to standard luminescence theory, we can date up to 2 D0, okay? And after that, we cannot do anything more. Of course, the more we deal with saturation levels, the more the signal gets higher. So it's very difficult. So It is quite important to understand that for the case of quartz and aluminum oxide, our beginning studies, for example, the D0s, the saturation points, were exceeded at least one order of magnitude for the case of aluminum oxide. You see here, normal aluminum oxide does not go higher than 10 grays. Here we have also 300 or 400 grays. And in the case of quartz, we have at least a saturation point that at least 5 times higher than the corresponding OSM. That means that we have deeper traps. Of course, the same happens with beryllium oxide, which is more or less similar to the main dosimetric traps. And however, it is important to understand that for in order to study a material, a technique, something, a methodology that can go farther and deeper in the past, we need signal with high lifetimes of the order of 10 to the 9 years or even more. And in the case of TAOSL, if you define that an ordinary trap, it was calculated almost 3 electron volts, this lifetime is achievable. We also have higher dose capacity. And of course, in many cases, we have insignificant unthermal fading, like anomalous fading, as it was studied in the case of reference material in Durango apatite, and a very extremely slow bleaching in the sun. You can see here, 50% after 1 month in summer sun conditions in Ankara. So one may very efficiently ask, if this signal is not bleached, okay, then what is the zeroing time? The zeroing time is friction, is heating at high temperature. So we can apply this technique to cases where we have mechanical treatment or thermal treatment, like a gauge fault in the seismology, in the earthquake studies we are using. Moreover, we could study the thermal behavior of the TAOSL signal of mixed mineralogy material, for example, including both feldspar and quartz. And we see that if we suggest the correct treatment, it's easy to isolate which technique, which signal comes from quartz and which signal comes from feldspar. So according to this methodology, we can have the options of going higher ages, of course. We have the options of avoiding chemical treatment for mineral separation in geological samples. And of course, since this material is not very well bleached, we can avoid making the presentation in red and dim light, okay? Of course, you can see that the main idea is also we can apply the SAR OSL protocol. Instead of making OSL measurements, we can make TAOSL measurements. So the only difference in this protocol will be, instead of steps 2 and steps 6, where there is a preheating in the ordinary SAR protocol, ordinary preheating is to erase the shallow traps. Okay, in the case of the TAOSL, we have a TL measurement at 500 degrees at the lowest heating rate in order to erase all signal from ordinary traps. Okay, so TL measurement changes instead of preheating. Of course, many parameters are to be studied, like the temperature of the stimulation measurement, okay, the test dose. And as you can see, it's important to use high test doses and high stimulation times and high temperatures in order to get a lower dispersion. Because if you use low temperatures, the dispersion is quite high. This was very well discussed in SSD 2016 in Munich. And of course, we had the chance to apply some dating results to sites. The first one was from Kula Geopark in Manisa in Turkey. It's supposed to be, I will skip the technical and the geological facts. It was dating using argon and it was almost like 1,200 years plus or minus using argon. Argon, it is supposed to be, we have the dose response curve, we have the scattering plot, we have the kernel density, the radial plot. You can see that the most important feature here is that we have relative standard error, which is very high in that case. And of course, the age and the equivalent dose have a lot high dispersion. And we still have for this UNESCO's World Cultural Heritage Site ages, which TOSL give between 1.05 to 1.43 million years, in good agreement with the geological span between 1 and 2.2 million years, and with good agreement, let's say, with the argon-argon technique, ranging, indicating 1.07 to 1.28 million years. Okay, still we haven't published these results because we need, they were presented in ASEAN Pacific LED 2018 in Beijing, but we still need to run more measurements. I have applied some more in Greek fault system. The geological and the paleomagnetic results were ranging between 1.4 mega million years. The TOSL indicated lower ages, but if you see, we have a problem here. The signal is a little bit complicated, is stable, if you see. Of course, it has a dose dependence, okay, but this signal, because this problem comes from tridymite, typical quartz type, doesn't give neither this peak shape signal nor the decaying signal. So in that cases, we have high recuperation values, more than 40%, and this is not, this gives lower, this underestimation of for the ages. Okay, so we also have problems with other materials in the case of TOSL. In while it worked very well for quartz and feldspar and apatites for the case of natural occurring minerals, in the case of tridymite, it has this type of problems. Of course, also in gypsum, there are some problems, and in calcium carbonate, we have big problems. Many types of materials were studied because TOSL could not be used only for extending age limits. It could be also used for extending dosimetric limits. These are the examples which I call bad examples for magnesium oxide. Why? Because if you see, magnesium oxide TAOSL dose response slope is much, much worse than the corresponding one with of the TL. So there are still materials that they do have TAOSL, they do have very deep traps, but the dosimetric properties are much, much worse than the corresponding TL or OSL. It's typical typical behavior of magnesium oxide and natural salt, which is not be used for extension of age limits or even dosimetric age, dosimetric limits. Okay, of course, these examples are very few. And another one is, besides this high recuperation value for the case of tridymite, obsidian and calcium carbonate also indicate very bad behavior on the TOSL signal. Of course, you can always remember that obsidian and calcium carbonate signals do not have natural OSL signal. Even natural OSL, ordinary OSL signal after natural irradiation, is flat. Okay? But, for example, in the case of calcium carbonate material, it is really important to understand that the signal is flat. In many cases, depending on the content, we can have some type of dose dependence. But please take a look at this plot. If you plot the natural, the natural TOSL signal versus the equivalent dose that we have calculated previously using TL in all calcium carbonate materials, you see that there is a trend, meaning the signal of the TOSL has a dependence on the equivalent dose, the natural dose that the signal has accumulated. So probably from this point of view, TOSL in the calcium carbonate could be easily used as a probe in order to have a rough estimation about the age of the material. Calcium carbonate, of course, is a low it's a low-level annual dose rate material in which we can also be used if you lower the low the dose rate. We can have high ages in many cases older than 1 and 1.5 million of years. Alternatively, we can use, besides of TAOSL, these are the other techniques and the other strategies for age limit extension using luminescence. Of course, for potassium feldspar, we can have IRPL, infrared photoluminescence, a new technique, optimization of various protocols, and optimization of the remodeling, the dose response curves using Lambert W function. But still, TAOSL, it's in quartz and feldspar, is a number one priority for as a new technique for age limit extension, and not to mention that we can use other material like apatites, which have not been traditionally used for dating using luminescence in the past. We have ongoing and future work, like we would like to make TAOSL measurements in other materials like feldspar, polymineral, lithium fluoride, lithium borate, and all other technical advanced materials that can be used for dosimetry. We need to make spectral response and time-resolved TAOSL measurements in collaboration with South Africa. We can study the universality of TAOSL properties in quartz samples in conducting in collaboration with BARC in Mumbai. Precision and improvement of SAR TAOSL protocol with USA. Age assessment, of course, using many samples, not only from Greece and Turkey, from all around the world. Monitor sensitivity changes. Simulation and modeling studies in collaboration with McDaniel College. Bleaching and zeroing studies, especially in quartz and feldspar. ESR spectroscopic studies and specific probable correlation of these very deep traps to aluminum or titanium centers in quartz. And of course, dating extraterrestrial samples, which could be the highest top of this stimulation. This is a recent presentation from our presentation in LED in 2017 in Cape Town, South Africa, where we could easily identify the very deep trap in Dunang apatite with one component in the EPR signal of this specific material. Of course, more studies should be performed, and especially in quartz. I mentioned before that the optically stimulated luminescence signal from Gaza review, it was a review article by Wintel and Adamitz, which in which this review special reference is devoted to TAOSL technique. Of course, very recently in 2019, a book was circulated, and chapter 4 is devoted to TAOSL by me and by Professor George Kittis. Of course, methodology and results were presented in Lumdata 2015 in Estonia, SSD 2016 in Munich, LED 2017 in Cape Town, South Africa, Asia Pacific LED in China, and SSD 2019 in Japan. These are the consortium people that laboratories that work. The red one is the founders, let's say. The blue one laboratories are currently working, and the green one are laboratories who were invited to join the collaboration and work in TAOSL signal. Thank you very much for everyone, and of course my thank you. I want to thank the organizing committee and all of you who listened, and of course my son, for which I devoted a lot of time instead of devoting to him. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor George Polymeris. Very nice, very interesting way that this approach is completely new seems very successful. I would like to ask for the audience if they have any questions. I don't see anything. Do you have an idea of the origin of these deep centers?
You mean from which point of view? Spectroscopically?
I don't know. It's from PROEC Unifest. Do you have an idea of the origin of this?
To be honest, I feel I have nothing to... I have not proof so yet. But I feel that these very deep traps in quartz specifically could be considered, could be the same as the aluminum and titanium center in EPR, which has similar properties like very slow bleaching and high dose saturation. And I will to study whether I can correlate them or not. But whether I have which impurities could be in other type of materials, unfortunately, I cannot say anything up to now. Of course, this is a topic that is open for study and research.
Okay.
Let me also remind you and invite you to the Asian Pacific LED conference, which the next one will take place in Turkey in 2022. It was supposed to be organized for this year, 2021, but due to the coronavirus situation, it was postponed and it will take place next year in Antalya, Turkey, and we will be co-organizers because it was organized by my previous laboratory and my previous place I have been worked for. So,
yes, the problems with coronavirus have moved a lot of also SSD will be not next year, will be the next one in Pisa. So people are postponing the conferences. Unfortunately, we had all these problems. But at least now, these vaccines is helping us. So we have another one. Thank you. We will try to use... is this the person that asked you about this, the idea of these deeper centers, they... So they will try to use this protocol here in Brazil. You are missing Brazil in this group of studies.
I would, you know, I was invited in 2017 by Sonia Tatumi to join one conference there, but my wife was pregnant, so I could not leave her. But if there is any chance, I will be. I would love to come and to work even in long distance with your laboratories.
One thing that I was thinking about is we always are taking these materials to measure annual dose rate for dating, but sometimes we are dating some materials that doesn't have effective Z like a soft tissue. There is some difference because when you irradiate the interference of these rays with low energy can make a much more induction of signal. So about this effectivity, don't you think that dosimetry for data should have appropriate dosimeters also consider this factor with effectivity? And this makes some difference in these deep traps?
To be honest, I can understand your question, but from my point of view, it depends on the age that you're looking for. If the age is young and you want to just make a better reproducibility or better, let's say, to reduce the error, yeah, or to make the more precise measurements, yes, you are right. We might consider the most appropriate luminescence dosimeter for dose rate. But when we deal with ages of the order of 1 million years or even more, errors of, according to my opinion, these errors are not more than 5 to 7%. I think for this type of ages, meaning what, 1 million of years and even more, these errors are not significant. But if you want to improve the credibility and the error in your general age, in ages lowest of the order of 200,000 years, yes, I agree with you, it should be most appropriate. But please see what is happening. Even today, many laboratories all over the world are still producing new materials, nanomaterials, micromaterials, whatever materials, but we are still stuck in lithium fluoride.
Exactly. And aluminum oxide for ourselves.
And yeah, to a lesser extent, but we are stuck to lithium fluoride, which is, yeah, we have 7 or 8 peaks depending on the fabrication. And okay, I think I will have to stop here.
Okay. I think we don't have any more questions. on the audience. Professor Sonia is telling that you are always welcome to visit us for a collaboration with you. So I think we can finish here. We have, there is one question more. What do you think about the deep traps dependent of the radiation source, gamma, beta, and dose rate from Fania Caicedo?
Can you read again the question?
What do you think about the deep traps dependent of the radiation source, gamma, beta, and dose rate?
Preliminary measurements that I have performed using beta and gamma indicate that the effectiveness is more or less the same. But I think that alpha radiation is could be even less effective ordinary. When we are doing luminescence measurements, we assume that the effectiveness of alpha is 0.1 if we don't bleach them, the grains. I think that the effectiveness of the alpha irradiation to the very deep traps might be even less than 0.5%. I think it's almost half as the ordinary TL or OSL, because ordinary we say that's around 10 to 12% for alpha. I think I wish I helped replying to the question. Otherwise, I have misunderstood the question.
Okay, I think I was in this direction, really. I think we don't have any more questions. We should move for the round table. You have the link in the chat to move there. It will be interesting roundtable about environment dosimetry. We invite you all to continue there. Thank you, Professor Polymeris.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.